I should have warned you ahead of time about this course. Some assembly is required. So I got as far as I could. I was even hoping for today to put together a prezi that would represent every site we visited on a map, so that you could start to realize that we have been to Japan several times. We've been to Java several times, China, India, the Andes. You've noticed over the course of the semester that we keep coming back to the same places. Wouldn't it be interesting for us to look at it together, just look at the Andes and see this site way back when, this site more recently, this site when the Spaniards came, etc. Well, sorry, we ran out of time. I leave that to you. So the assembly that I recommend, and there's no better time to engage in this than between now and Monday, because you will get multiple benefits. You won't just consolidate your grasp and command of the material. You will also be in a position to benefit grade-wise from having assembled that and consolidated your grasp now rather than 10 years from now when you and your spouse are visiting the Andes, which would be a great time to go back and revisit your notes and say, okay, I'm really going to figure this out. I had this. I just don't remember it. Now, where am I going to visit in the Andes where I can really feel it and sense it and experience it firsthand? The obvious way to reassemble this course is in proper chronological order. Oh, thank God. Start from the beginning and move to the future. The other way to do it is, as I mentioned, according to place. And then the other way, which would definitely help you on the midterm exam, I mean the final exam, is to identify themes, connect the dots. What did the Persians do that is similar to what we saw the Spaniards do in Cartagena, for example? Those types of connections will allow you to respond to the very specific questions on the exam, where you're going to be given a building or a site and asked to connect that site to some other site of your choice. Which one to choose? The one with the thematic connection that you can most effectively support in around 100 words. Is there going to be a new question type on the final exam? No. I've decided to just stop already, okay? There's enough moving parts in this course, don't you agree? Enough. Three types of questions, that's enough. Let's just, no one gets hurt. Let's just go home and be safe. Okay. So I'm hopefully going to move through enough of this so that there's time for questions. But just in case, ask questions while we go through. Am I going to cover the entire semester? No, you now have a recording that covers the first half of the semester. So if it's all right with you, I will just leave it to me, my former me, to help you through that, with that, you know, have access to that review lecture on the midterm material. Is that okay? If the opportunity presents itself, please ask about or point out connections between this material and previous material. The exam, yes, the test is on everything. And so a little bit more about the test. The cool thing about tests is they are significant incentive structures. And I don't have to tell you that. You know that. So it's not just a means to an end, but it's also what we're studying in this course. We are studying incentive structures. This is a history of how humans establish systems. The system part of this course, Sites and Systems, is all about incentive structures and how people can make a choice and it results in a thing. Yeah, that can be very important. But the biggest choices, the ones that have the most leverage, are the choices that establish systems of incentive structures that structure our behaviors. Right from the first day of class, we talked about how this room structures our behaviors in conjunction with the institutional practices of MIT and formal education generally. Architecture, in combination with institutional regimes, structure the choices we make. Can we make any choice we want? Of course you can. We're Americans, we can do anything we want. But do the structures within which we face those choices affect the choices we make individually and collectively? They certainly seem to. So the real levers of history are these systems that structure choices that individuals and collective entities make. And the test. There is a test on Monday, and the incentive structures of the course, I'm trying to manipulate you to master this material with the eye on Monday. But that's not the test I care about. The test is not on Monday. The test is 3 weeks from now, when you overhear your parents being dismissive about climate change, there's no hope. That's the test. How do you respond? The test is also 3 years from now, when you're on the elevator with your CEO, and he says, with some of your colleagues, and he says, okay, what's going on? And you either respond with an intelligent answer or you don't, and your colleague responds, and they get the promotion instead of you. The test is also 3 decades from now, when you are the one who got the promotion. You and your collaborators are trying to decide whether to go for it or sit back. And you have the opportunity to be effective in making an argument to say, yes, we should do this. We cannot, it's not just going to make this one little change, but it can make a systemic change that might give us hope. Because the test is not on Monday, the test is 3 weeks, 3 years, and 3 decades from now, the course is not over either. You're going to have to reassemble it on your own, hopefully between now and Monday. But you should also reassemble it every time you are choosing where to go on vacation. Please send me some pictures that will help me teach the course more effectively. I promise to share those pictures. You may or may not be aware of this, but everything prepared for you in this course this semester is also being shared with a larger network, and your help in refining and improving the materials will help not just me, but the larger family of instructors of history that are trying to do a better job covering non-European topics. So any input, there's places to comment in the screencast, lecture capture. You can send me emails. You can send me photos. Try to take photos from an elevated point of view so that future students can have greater access to stuff they can analyze with high resolution. And so the course doesn't end. And the larger issues of the course starts with the question, as everything starts with, who am I? And I don't mean me, I mean you. Who are you? And what is going on? And that's how we started the course, with the first class focusing on MIT, the here and now, our experience shared together in this room. Now, the difference is, in my generation, that's where it stopped. Believe it or not, when I was your age, it was still the Cold War, something we studied back in history in this course. And we knew how the world was going to end. We knew it with absolute certainty that one of two men was going to push a button or not. And it had nothing to do with us. There was nothing we could do about it, really. And so we just we stopped there. Who am I and what's going on if I'm curious? Well, you are the first generation, as we pointed out, who will attain a position of leadership conscious of the Anthropocene epoch of history where humans make a difference. It's not just whether we push the button or not. If we don't push the button, the Earth will change, will go in this direction or that direction, depending on the sum total of other choices made. Those other choices will be guided, not determined, but guided to a large extent by the systems we establish. Thus, the necessity of setting up, changing the way we teach, changing the way our education system works. We can't afford to have another generation of replicants of us. We need a generation that is actually engaged and takes command of the agency with which you can, if you so choose, control. And so there are things you can do. My generation, and so what is this word reflexive that we keep using? What does that mean? What is reflexive? What is reflex? Right? The doctor does this to your knee, and you don't think about kicking, it just happens. That is a characteristic of a system. So it's an automatic response that is pre-programmed into your knee joint. And so reflexivity is an automatic response that is preset. The other meaning of reflexive is that you don't just wait until the end of the movie and see how it turns out. You keep an eye out for unintended consequences of choices we make, and we adjust things as we go along. So there's an adaptive flexibility. We're constantly checking in. This is the negative feedback loop that you learned in engineering systems theory. Whether it was electrical or hydraulic or whatever system you're talking about. Reflexivity is the operation of these feedback loops in real time before it's too late. If only we had had that at the start of the 20th century, we might have turned the ship a little bit to the left and instead of heading full speed over the cliff. And so that's the key. So when we walk into this room and it's frigid once again, my generation says, eh, what's the point? Yes, there's a reflexive mechanism on the wall back there that was designed to constantly and automatically adjust the temperature of the room. But I'm used to saying, it's probably locked. There's nothing we can do about it. Whatever happens, happens. But your generation gets up, walks back there and says, no, maybe we can adjust this. And I say, didn't do anything, right? And Dariel says, no, it made a sound. No, it's going to work. I said, okay, good. That's what this course is about. So, so it's not just who am I and what's going on. For your generation, it goes on. It's like, who are we? What can we do? And how are we going to do it? So a whole new set of rules, I like to call them Missouri rules. You don't just trust what people tell you, you verify. And you verify by applying the rules of evidence rigorously to everything you are taught, everything you encounter, every assertion on the internet. You say, okay, let's see if that's true. And you verify, you test it. You look for the interpretation in relationship to the reality of the world, number one. The number one source of all our understanding is the world. The interpretation is something we don't just take for granted. We don't just accept it. We test it. We verify. And that's what the analysis projects were all supposed to do. And so, and that's what we do. Moving through this material, and we don't just look at the things that are interesting in their own right, we look at the consequences. Unless there are significant consequences of the evidence and the history available to us, then we don't look at it. We only look at the things, hopefully, or at least that's how I was trying to filter the material of this course, is through the filter of, does it matter? Does it make a difference? Were there consequences? did it alter the system of incentives? Did it alter the choices? Did it alter the outcomes that we care about in history? And so that's the test. And that's also the way we looked at this material. It's a pretty pattern on the ochre piece in Blombos Cave. But what does it matter? And so the handouts, you may have noticed over the course of the semester, it got more and more demanding of me to get to the point. What's the point of this? You're showing this evidence, so what's the point? And by being more demanding on the material I present, that allows me to be more demanding of you on what you report back on the exam, and hopefully what you're able to do when you get into real life situations. So those handouts are a guide to what, as you know already from the quizzes, you know that those handouts are a guide to how to look at this material in a way where you can respond intelligently in about 100 words to what's the evidence, what's the interpretation of the evidence. So it's Missouri rules. You're not allowed to make any claims about this or that evidence unless you are able to show the evidence and make that connection in a convincing way. So with that in mind, we turn to the material itself and quickly moving in chronological order, thank God, from the Big Bang, we jump up to Blombos Cave, our first site. And this sheet that you have is a pairing of site and system. The site is the easy part. That's the flashcard part of the course. It'd be nice if it'd be useful for you to be aware of that. Really, the only place on the exam you're going to need that part of the material that it won't be given to you already in the exam is in the third question type, where I'm going to give you one site and say, choose a second site. And so when you present that second site, it sure would be useful to know the identifying information of that site. Yes?
Does that second site have to be one of the other 91 sites?
No. But plan A, if you have a compelling site that was mentioned in the course or not, we'll do our homework. So we, as in they, will do the homework necessary to see if your argument holds any weight. Hopefully, the evidence you present will mean that they don't need to look up the other thing. You're presenting your evidence, and they're just verifying. How long is the exam? The exam period, I believe, is really long, right? It's 1:30 to 4:30? Well, knowing you guys, you want that whole time. And knowing you guys, if you're being asked to answer 8 out of the 10 questions or 8 of the 11 questions or 10 of the 13 questions, some of you are going to answer all of them. Well, I am hereby instructing the TAs to grade the first, if it asks for 8 out of the 11 given, they are instructed hereby to grade the first 8 they encounter. And 9, 10, 11, you did it for your own entertainment value. And you're welcome to do that. But I don't want to overload the TAs. It's just too much. If everyone answers all 11 questions, it's just too much. Is that okay? Yes?
If we write in more questions, but don't want the first 8 chosen, can we write grade lists or like circle?
You can cross out the ones you don't want graded, just to be clear. Yeah. That's not a bad strategy. I like that. You can select your own top 8 responses. Excellent idea. Other questions about those mechanics? Okay, so I'm going to be focusing on themes here. That in Blombos Cave, we use the evidence of Blombos Cave. This is so far back in time, and the cave itself is, some would argue, a found object. So what's the architecture? Well, we're using, again, architecture with a small a is referring to material culture, evidence of human intention. And that human intention is not individual human intention in this case. It's very rare in history that individual human intention is what matters. It's the intentions of collective social organizations, and that's what inspires Mark Jarzembeck and us to embrace his idea of the social package. So this is a social package, and it's tools that are never only functional. They are always functional, plus there are many, many other things. And the larger system that this indicates is the system of human migration, which is both a function of species, the social package itself, and the geography that we encounter on this planet. This planet gave us a very fixed set spatial, formal spatial arrangement of resources. And those resources, to a large extent, constrain. They don't determine. Remember, we're avoiding those hard verbs. We're acknowledging the relationship between structures and individual agency, individual and collective agency. The geography, the geology does not determine it. It incentivizes, it structures, it influences the distribution of humanity and their social groupings on the planet. It's both a species thing and a social organization thing and a geography landscape thing. Okay? I'm going to start out a little slow and then pick up the pace markedly as we go, as we get the hang of this. Our next site is Çatalhöyük in Anatolia. And this is the image that kind of gave us the most audacious interpretation of what it must have been like in these very interiorized cells of the honeycomb of Çatalhöyük. The representational systems that we speculate about, the religious system that formed. And here's where we start to see evidence of it counters the later period of Mesopotamia, where we're quick to generalize and say, okay, humanity went through this stage and it became an agricultural revolution that happened really quickly and became cities and specialization. Not so fast. There are many ways to get to these things we refer to awkwardly as civilizations. And there is nothing revolutionary about the switch to planting. And as a matter of fact, it wasn't a switch. It was many, many switches. And it wasn't in one direction. It went in two directions. We switched to carefully domesticated plants, and then we switched back to undomesticated plants throughout a long period of history, thousands of years. And Çatalhöyük gives us evidence of that. And in the midst of that, we start to see long-distance trade networks, not that any single person carrying a single thing, but through networks and chains, links in the chain across large landscapes. Some parts of the landscape are resourced in a way that they have an advantage of producing one thing over another area, and it's through exchange. And in this case, obsidian is the thing to mention in Çatalhöyük, because that's what was the great source of specialization and wealth at Çatalhöyük. They had access to rich resources of obsidian, the hardest material known at that time, useful for tool making, also symbolic systems, depending on these precious stones. So ask a question at any point. Stonehenge slides out of order. There it is. Stonehenge, what do we know? Very little. What do we suspect? Is that the society responsible for this particular configuration that we inherit today was around 2400s, people we call the beaker people, because they left these ceramic beakers. And we think it has something to do with the sun, based on our interpretation of this. But the larger issue here is that there have been, historians like to favor old things, and so we say there were three distinct social groups that engaged at this site. They all had something to contribute in terms of solar orientation, but different groups also added layers of meaning and layers of construction associated with those layers of meaning at different moments. And then Barbara Bender is quick to point out, well, it's still going on. You have the Druids, you have the preservation freaks of United Kingdom, you have UNESCO, and you have the hippies, and it continues. So we have lots of different social organizations adding layers of meaning and layers of construction, including the preservation efforts and the landscape surrounding this. And it really is a large landscape phenomena with constructions that extend across this region of England. It's arguably as far as the quarries, 200 kilometers away, and involving whole towns. The Darrington Walls were mentioned, Stonehenge. One interpretation is Darrington Walls was the symbol of life, Stonehenge the symbol of death, and the journey between across this manipulated landscape, having certain meanings, having to do with that scenario. Easter Island, very recent, and a morality tale, according to Gerard Diamond, about the importance of history. I would say not just history, but understanding how incentive structures work. The migrants in canoes across the ocean reach Easter Island, same time as Hawaii, and they establish, in the context of great surplus, they don't need to spend all day every day just taking care of their own needs. They have surplus time, and like we've seen in other cases, another opportunity for connection, they invest that surplus time and resources in monument construction, in the social systems that take on a life of their own, which we'll see later in the religious systems that take hold. So that's the first lecture. Now, the second lecture, we were looking at water cities, and so we look at very specific water networks. The first one in South America, in the Andes, Coral River. Again, a rich symbolic religious system involving a labyrinthine complex and a stone circle for the collective group that we don't know a lot about. But we do know, we are learning more and more about the system of the vertical archipelago of this region and how different towns communicated with other towns in this system of very geographically constrained setting of river valleys and the coastal areas and the kind of exchanges that occurred there that made it possible for large groups of people to live in high density on very compact sites, implying something other than agricultural production as the main force operating in society. Yes, we're still in order. The Nile River water system was so dependable for thousands of years of regular seasonal flooding in a predictable manner. The isolation of this valley resulted in a society that didn't have to worry too much about attacks from across the desert or across the sea. It was highly stable for a very, very long time and survived and thrived according to a certain conservatism. They did not change a lot. And they had, again, a huge surplus. They had three times the capacity to, they could have fed a population three times their size. And instead of letting all that food go to waste, they invested a lot of resources in their death cult, in these huge monuments. And the specifics of the religious ceremony is something we went through in the lecture. Each aspect of that ceremonial life, in relationship to each feature of the complex, is available to you for deployment as evidence of how the death cult society operated, and there's no time to go into each one of them, of course. But the context of this very narrow, linear city, basically, of empty landscape except for the rich, seasonally flooded cropland in the delta. This is north, off that way, off to your right. remarkable geology and geography that to a large extent contributed to the characteristics of Egyptian civilization as it developed. No questions? The Indus River Valley, obsession with the water that was much more difficult to manage than we see at the Nile. That flooding, flash floods because of ice jams and landslides in the Himalayas. And so they, their constructions reflected, like the Dutch, a very strict management of water in the landscape necessitated by repeated disasters. And thus, they went even further and made it a major point of their social amenity life, their infrastructure, leading to what many believe to be a highly stable, peaceful society. Also, part of this larger network, over 1,500 sites of this civilization and culture, living mostly without warfare, dramatically shifting when the Saraswati River goes dry. Questions? Yu, the Great of China, we don't have anything to look at that he directly influenced, but he is, but in a way we can learn a lot about the way he is historicized by later generations, thus the backward direction of the course, to help us see those layerings of interpretations. But the canal system remains a fundamentally crucial aspect of Chinese, the way the Chinese society operates economically and socially and physically, structuring the key cities along the Grand Canal. And so the stories that are told, whether Yu the Great existed or not, tells us a great deal about how important management of the landscape in terms of this precious water resource as a transportation network, and also as a flood prevention thing, and the veneration for channeling the water, not trying to block it and stop it. Then we move on to
So a lot of times on the quizzes, they'll ask questions about the architecture.
Mm-hmm.
But like the sites, like the canal, it's kind of hard.
Very hard.
So what? Like
I had damn well better not ask you about the architecture in this case. I might ask which of the following are is not true about the canal system. I might ask that. I will ask that.
Okay, I think with like the Library of Alexandria, I think you'd ask about like the architecture of it. That was a bit confusing.
Ask this again, and if you have it, if you have it, it'd be great to be specific, so I can give you a good answer. Third lecture, tentatively called Cosmic Centers, I'm tempted to call it Urban Transitions and the Different Paths to Urban Society. Here's one path in Uruk, where we see this stone cone mosaic temple. We don't know a lot about it, but what we do know suggests that it was a fertility, a piece of ritual architecture to sustain the fertility of this tremendously innovative attitude towards the landscape of the Iraqi swamps at the mouth, the delta of the Tigris and Euphrates, the Euphrates River specifically, where extreme intervention in the landscape in the form of irrigation required unprecedented organizational skills to manage that landscape, again, as we saw in the Netherlands, to keep the levees maintained. Every link in the chain has to be solid or else the whole place floods. The social organization connected with the physical requirements of infrastructure leads to a highly organized urban civilization. It was a primate city. It was so much larger than every other city around it. And it developed writing, which then spread, we believe, to Egypt. And it was sustained by This long-distance trade that the irrigation allowed a productive surplus of agricultural wheat and barley that then could be exchanged for other things in which is how networks of trade and exchange developed. The city of Mari had a specific purpose to connect via horse, then later camel, across the desert to the Mediterranean Sea and the Nile River. A bonus slide. We usually only get two slides per topic. Here's a bonus slide. It gives us these features of the harbor, fortress, canal, factory town, which we will see in multiple other sites as we move forward in history. A good candidate for a connection that you can make. And if you say Ur, that's great, because the best slide we have is Ur. But if you say Uruk or Mari, they had similar formations, and it's all good. Okay. TAs, take note. Here we have, on the island of Crete, the labyrinth of Knossos. I'm calling it a labyrinth because we're not sure King Minos actually existed, but we call it the Minoan society after King Minos. And this, it's oddly open to the landscape. And the arts and the colors are so in line, in tune with contemporary aesthetics now that we look back on this and wistfully imagine a very positive attitude socially, overlooking the human sacrifice to the bull gods, representative of Zeus. We see this as a very positive thing, and a lot of architectural fantasies were in play in the 19th and 20th century with the reconstruction of the palace. When you do visit there, those of you who go, take it with a grain of salt. There's a lot of fantastical repaintings of these beautiful dolphin mosaics. And this one I brought in because it was shown elsewhere, but it's very useful because it shows the connections between Crete and Mycenaean Greece. After, you'll recall, after the tsunami earthquake volcano disaster on Terra, the Minoan civilization kind of collapsed and the Mycenaean Greeks took over and used a lot of their architectural practices in their own constructions on the Greek peninsula and elsewhere that they colonized. Now, for something totally different, 800 BC, Chavín de Huántar in the Andes. Again, we see a labyrinth of individual spiritual journey and exploration, communing with the gods embodied through this stele at the center of the labyrinth. Again, benefiting from the vertical archipelago, something quite comparable, hint to the Mesopotamian situation where you see very distinct geological, geographical conditions leading to advantages for producing different things that then mobilizes an exchange network that reaches eventually to a fairly long distance trade. And thus cultural influence. So we're still trying to figure it out, but it's okay to speculate at this point that the connections up and down the coast reached as far as Central America, because we see in Mexico some influence, and as far south as the later we look at the Inca. So between the Aztec and the Inca, there are connections that we look at later. Been to China, and this remarkable first emperor, for all his paranoia, did an awful lot to construct the infrastructure, the physical trappings, the physical fabric of empire that, to a certain extent, left an imprint that we see even to today. He joined together a Great Wall of China, but more importantly, he connected with a short canal two of the largest river systems in the world, leading to an extension of what Yu the Great did. And isn't it nice that I can refer to things that came earlier in time? let me do it in this direction. And his paranoia manifested in this remarkable tomb complex. This is just one site on the outer edge, 7,000 terracotta warriors. Here's his canal. So the larger system manifestation is not about the wall. It's more about the connectivity and the trade that that continues to be an important part of China. The next lecture, lecture four, the classical worlds, we picked four sites. The first one is not this. Where it is? There it is. So the Persian Achaemenid, Achaemenid Persian palace complex of Persepolis. Again, very audacious artistic renderings given the paucity of evidence, but this is the elaborate architectural manifestation of this remarkable empire that was created across this region, connecting the Silk Routes off to the east, are connected for the first time across the deserts of Central Asia all the way to the Mediterranean Sea. And down, as you see, into Egypt, and I go back to this, and the tulip capitals are in part, this whole dialogue of architectural form in part is influenced by Egyptian precedents, as are the practice of the bas-reliefs, narrative sculptures of the walls. And back. The next one should be Parthenon. The Parthenon was built at a moment in the history of Greece when Pericles had led the Greek city-state to a series of spectacular victories over rivals of the region, and was in a position to celebrate the grand achievements of Greek society and philosophy. Notably and memorably, and something you probably had in civics class since third grade, this idea of democracy, of one man, one wealthy white, non-slave, property-owning man, one vote. But that longer version is hard to say. It doesn't trip off the tongue. But very limited extension of democracy beyond the ruling, the handful of rulers. And thus, we consider it to be the birthplace of democracy. And this construction was both a monument to the glorious victories of the Greek warriors, but also the relationship between the Greek people and the gods, and likening the Greek people to godlike qualities of the Greek gods. And so this was an exuberant moment of cultural production that lasted not very long, but the Greek ideals lasted way beyond what the Greek society that gave birth and supported them did. And as a bonus slide, we get this idea of skeuomorphism, of rendering in one material forms that were generated by the logic of a different material. In this case, the wood structure of standard construction methods gets immortalized in the permanence of stone. And we see this not just in Greek, Roman, Renaissance, neoclassical architecture. We see it again in Buddhist Sanchi in India. So stay tuned for that. Again, adjusting for the shuffle. We go to the Library of Alexandria. And Alexander the Great, freakishly successful at despite a very short life, conquering in one grand journey, most of the known world at that time, at least to the societies around Greece. He came from the area just north of Greece, Macedonia. And the interesting thing about what he does, he engages when confronted with a cultural competition with the Persians, he encourages intermarriage, and he actually negotiates intermarriage, and he starts to wear Persian clothing himself to try to create literally and figuratively a marriage between Persian and Greco-Macedonian cultures. When confronted with Egypt, he takes a different approach. He doesn't want to marry the Egyptian culture. He wants to argue against all evidence to the contrary. He wants to argue for the supremacy of Greek culture over Egyptian culture. And so he builds this library that collects the writings and books of the Greek world and beyond, but not so much the Egyptian world. And so he's collecting the books and confiscating them, making copies and putting them in this library. It becomes a very important precedent. He learns this trick when he visits and conquers Nineveh and the library of Ashurbanipal. That was a minor site in that lecture. Question about Alexander the Great's library in the quiz. Yeah, we don't know what the architecture was because we don't even know where it is. And these are crazy speculative things that Carl Sagan is walking through. Or a video game designer is saying, this would be cool in Assassin's Creed. So I don't recall what the question was, but of the things covered in the main lecture, I would have chosen three that I thought were important, and one try to throw you off. And so in the multiple choice question, I would do that. But in the open response question, I would have said, name two aspects of, in some of these cases, when I say name two aspects of Alexander the Great's library in Alexandria, the way you should embrace that and that challenge is two aspects of the story we tell, or the story I told, about the speculations that we believe because we have this limited evidence, but and this is, I want to point out, I don't buy this. I buy this, a Greek god, yes. An Egyptian pharaoh, Alexander the Great dressed up as Egyptian pharaoh? No, that doesn't fit the evidence that there was a competitive relationship between Greek and Egyptian culture. So I think that's where they got this artist rendering wrong. And I'm not sure what the evidence that they brought to this. When I teach a seminar on this topic, we'll dig into that. But for now, I'm going on record as saying that is not correct. It doesn't fit with the story of Greek dominance. Is that okay? Okay. Thank you for bringing that up. So the Roman world, the Pantheon. Outside, it's a Greek temple. Inside, it's a whole new animal. And again, it's a monumental tribute to the glory that is Rome, which is a quote from some British accent Roman fictional Hollywood movie. But this idea of Rome as this conquering empire that so appeals to us in the 20th century, and this innovation of use of concrete, something that was discovered laying around. It worked during the Roman reign, but then we lost track of that method until the 19th century. But a remarkable deployment of the Greek structural technology of trabeation extended further with the Etruscan arch technologies and brought together in sometimes extremely elaborate vaulted structures of arches and barrel vaults and domes. Here, the apotheosis of which was this tremendous dome which took centuries to surpass. And the coffering and the visual aspects and the concealment of the weight of the whole thing by dressing it in this colorful, panelized Greek costume. And the larger empire that grows and grows and grows through a system of incentives for the Roman soldiers. You conquer this land, you get the spoils of this land, you get to settle in the form of a Roman camp, which became the cities of Europe. They reached from the British Isles throughout Spain, north of Africa, up through this entire vast area surpassed only later by the Mongols. And in a bonus sequence of slides, here we see Florence, Italy. There's the Il Duomo, the church we'll be visiting in a few moments. And we see the Roman core. We see the extension of the walls as the success of the city requires them to expand through different periods of history that are still legible when you go to Florence. Impress your travel companions with this remarkable parlor trick of reading the fabric in a historical manner. Okay, hopefully that's it for the scrambled slides. Again, picking up the pace. Hinduism. Cremation, veneration of water. This remarkable site of the Ganges River, the mythology of the gods, the earring dropping from the burning corpse of Shakti, and the pilgrimage routes that are part of the ritual reenactment through the body moving in space. So the architecture of the city and the network of temples and the pilgrimage route is a way of structuring and choreographing the travel of individual worshipers through the space of the city as a mode of religious veneration. Very complex. And then the simplification of it through the abstraction of the architectural representation of all the different shrines of the city through a sequence that allows them to more efficiently fulfill the same spiritual obligations. Remarkable. Tamil Chola Emperor Rajaraja I in 1003 in this Brihadeshvara temple in Thanjavur outdoes everybody, overshoots all his rivals by a long shot. All the different features of Hindu temple architecture are expanded and exaggerated. Instead of one level, there's a second level that represents Rajaraja's benevolent granting of access to the realm of the gods, the largest linga, the largest tower, the most dematerialized, the most ornate capitals, columns moving in towards the center. And it was part of a developmentalist empire where the technical methods of irrigation, flood control. Again, you see a theme here of development for economic production and the organization of the social systems of using temples as a bank, as a bank branches where resources are pooled and offered back as investment for kind of a development plan. Expansion that leads us very quickly to the next site, the Khmer site of Angkor Wat, which is a Chola Mandalam extension where this system is put into practice on a grand scale, the grand stone monumentalization of this religious, Hindu religious cosmological model of the universe that later is redeployed as a Buddhist sanctuary. But here we see the irrigation system, the geology and geography of the Mekong River, where the river floods. There's a Mount Mahameru to become the model of the center of the universe. And these river systems that allow these large ghats to wats in this in the Khmer language to retain the water for use in irrigation that is only available in this zone, but it's a highly productive band that's all at a similar level where irrigation can reach. A remarkable feat of engineering that challenges us to keep upgrading our estimates of what the population it supported must have been. And then a bonus slide of the remarkable sculptural narratives of the churning of the Milky Ocean that support this Hindu cosmological storytelling that is not just in the material arts, but also performing arts. That we can see largely intact to the present moment, despite the shenanigans of the current king. We see the same cosmological modeling of the Hindu universe here done in wood, not in stone, but maintained through a sequence of rituals through to the present. The seven ring oceans, the vast ocean beyond the seven rings of continent, ocean, continent, and the center architecturalization of Mahameru, the center, the abode of the gods, the most sacred part of the palace. And as you enter towards the center, your behavior changes, your vocabulary changes, the language you speak changes. There are three levels of the Javanese language, and there's a specific set of vocabulary items reserved for when you speak with the king. So the language changes as you enter the inner sanctum, and as you move out from the center, you have fewer and fewer expectations that people even understand high Javanese. They only speak the low Javanese, and they dress the way they dress. And there's this remarkable capacity for syncretic adaptation that they call Javanization. They take whatever element they're confronted with, and that might actually be threatening their very existence, like Dutch colonialism, and they embrace it, and they say, oh, you're not the other, you're not the enemy, you're Javanese. You fit within the Javanese worldview. So that adaptation is a strategy for survival. Buddhism. We start with Ashoka's shock and awe at his own terrible consequences of warfare, and he vows to become a lifelong supporter of Kisma, the path of peace and enlightenment and enlightened kingship, and spreads that not only by constructing a very specific series of elements, architectural elements in the Mahastupa complex in Sanchi, but also in the distribution of these columns throughout the world, wherever he can reach, including beyond the boundaries of this map, that eventually reaches Southeast Asia, China, and then eventually Japan. And speaking of China, as Buddhist teachings and teachers travel over the centuries, these are not Ashoka's priests and ambassadors, there are later waves of priests and ambassadors. But with every wave of influence, there is a process of concept matching. We have in China, we have Taoism, we have Confucianism, and when the Buddhist teachings are comprehensible to us, according to our well-established Taoist and Confucius teachings, we embrace them and we accept them. Where it has no precedence in Taoist or Confucius teachings, they're invisible to us and we don't embrace those. So it's an interesting thing that happens with the teachings and the architectural forms, where the stupa is reinterpreted under the influence of the Ta watchtowers as these pagodas, first done in stone, in wood, and then later more permanently in stone. And we see this rich, long period of history. We keep coming back to Chang'an, also known as Xi'an, in China, where dynasty after dynasty, prior to the establishment of Beijing, create or contribute to the development of this capital city, including the Daming Palace. Here we see representations of this kind of competitive religious economy of thought between Taoist, Confucius, Buddhist shrines throughout this structured administrative system of a city, where we see a lot of what we recognize more recently in China of this strict ordering of relationships as a cultural norm to manage the social progress of large groups. Then Buddhism finally makes it to Korea, and then from Korea makes the leap over to Japan, where Japan adapts it according to their pre-existing, similar to what we saw in China, the Shinto religion and its own architectural practices. First, there's the very strong influence of the Korean practices, but then we see a distinct shift in the axial layout. If you look back, something to note as you study is that it shifts from being aligned along one axis, as they would in Korea, to being distributed, and the axis is now cutting through this way, and you see the pagoda and the central Kondo Hall with its accommodation of the structural limitations of timber construction, where in order to make a larger hall, they extend the bays with the wooden structures so they can still be building in wood. And we see our favorite cloud brackets up there as well. And so here's kind of a summary of the, over many, many centuries, the proliferation of Buddhism from place to place that we visit, leading us to the final place. And don't forget about Shintoism, the bonus slide of the Issei Shrine, rebuilt every 20 years as to renew the structure. But we land in Java, as far away as Java, where the building itself is an instrument of meditation. You walk up each level, circumambulating the temple, meditating on the stories of the sculptural walls, of the lessons of Buddha's life, until reaching the realm of formlessness, moving across level 6 up to level 7, where everything gives way. All the rectilinearity, all the cacophony of all these Buddhas and stories, there's a calmness, a serenity, a formlessness, and you open up to the view of the valley and the volcanoes beyond. Bringing us abruptly to Christianity. And again, we're out of sequence, but I'm just going to go with whatever sequence the slide says. You have the proper sequence in your notes and in this handout. St. Mark's Basilica, where the importance of St. Mark, because he visited Venice once, that the merchants abscond with the bones of St. Mark, bring it back to St. Mark's Basilica, where they get interred and become a basis for the authority of the church and the greatness of the city-state of Venice that becomes a dominant player in terms of trade, but also a key actor in the mobilization of logistics of the Crusades, which they used to their advantage by sponsoring the Fourth Crusade, which we talked about, disastrously ignoring the infidels of Islam occupying the Holy World and got distracted and instead sacked the Eastern church capital of Constantinople, from which it never quite recovers fully, and leaving it open to later conquest by the Ottoman Empire. And then this amazing story that Mark Garzenbeck tells about King Lalibela and his visions in a dream of the loss of Jerusalem to the Muslims, and thus the necessity of constructing a new Jerusalem here on earth through these rock-cut churches, that the technology of rock-cut architecture is thought by Mark Garzenbeck, understandably based on the evidence, to have traveled along this route and from India over to Lalibela. And this amazing story. Bonus slide on hydrological mastery. Chartres Cathedral in France, the most remarkably complete achievement of the Gothic episode of our story. The resources of the entire region and arguably the landscape of what we now call France, because of, the power of the relics, this cloak that is supposedly of Mary, used by Mary throughout her life, the cloak resides here, and the importance of the Virgin Mary cult of the Roman Church attracts a great deal of funding and support, which allows them to build one of the grandest cathedrals ever, built over many many decades, changing in style as they go, and is exemplary of this larger system of pilgrimage routes built around these relics. Every church that is able to claim with some credibility to have a relic of a saint or one of the characters of the original tale of Christianity becomes the object of visitations, especially in Jubilee years where you get indulgences like frequent flyer miles off your time in purgatory. Sorry about going backwards again, but Hagia Sophia in Constantinople, Emperor Justinian, after a long period of the fall of Rome and the Western Empire, reestablishes a Roman Empire based in Byzantium in Constantinople and reconquers much of what had been the Roman Empire and builds this remarkable, again, a quantum leap. If we didn't know history better, we'd say aliens must have told him how to do this. It's such an amazing achievement. But this high dome, perforated at the base, a ribbed dome, supported on these arches, and down through this stacked pile of sequence of arches, semi-domes, more arches, vaulted galleries, all the way down to the ground, and these very heavy piers that are perforated to be used as space of worship in the church. Alhambra. Where's this? So what are we not seeing? Okay, we did all of Christianity. Here we see, okay, it's not the Alhambra, it's the Great Mosque of Cordoba, 784. The Muslims sweep up from Africa with the exiled prince from the Umayyad Empire, sweep up and conquer all of the Iberian Peninsula. And where there had been a Roman temple and then a Christian church, he establishes a mosque that expands through multiple expansions and results in this remarkably rich architecture of arches and a mihrab that is the subject of this Orientalist fantasy of the evil, militarily ambitious Islamic rulers that are a threat to us Christians in Europe, which comes into the tale later up to the present. But these multiple extensions, and then once the Spaniards reconquer the peninsula, they establish a cathedral in the center of the mosque, and one of the weirdest constructions of this history. Then we have, we're really looking at the Dome of the Rock. Very early on in Islam, the story of Muhammad's night journey to the heavens, where Allah teaches him the practices of prayer five times a day. And that site is commemorated through this remarkable construction of the dome, which is itself it's a reproduced with difference emulation of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Sorry about that long. And here's the competition spatially in Old Jerusalem between the Dome of the Rock and the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. That continues to the present, one of the most contested pieces of land in the world throughout history. What do we got? Mansa Musa, the king of Timbuktu, goes on a Hajj And in the process, he has so much gold, and he brings thousands of people with him. When he gets to Cairo, he gives away so much gold, the price of gold collapses and has a huge impact. But he's so impressed with what he learns and finds, he gets in touch with Islamic scholarship, and he comes back with an architect to build in the local vernacular of mud and wood construction the mosque of Jingare Bara in Timbuktu, renewed every season with a new coat of mud applied by hand, but also establishes this practice, this high veneration for Islamic scholarship that we see throughout the history of Islam. Then we see the Masjid e Jame, which means the Friday mosque. Friday is the day of the Friday sermon at noon, the biggest day of the Islamic week. and so it's the biggest mosque of Isfahan. Isfahan in Persia, what we know now as Iran. And part of this vast network of caravanserai. Whenever we look at the Islamic fabrics, it's not just a church, it's not just a temple. The mosque is part of an urban complex that mobilizes a community of the true believers. You cannot be, unlike Hinduism, which is a very individualized worship practice, Islam is a group thing. You need a community of believers in order to support the Islamic life. And so it's never just a mosque. It's a complex with colleges, halls of study, libraries, marketplaces. It's a complex, the neighborhoods of the mosque hierarchy. So it's a complex thing, including at most mosques, a facility, a caravanserai, a hostel for traveling merchants to go and not be tempted by the sinful ways of traveling men, but can be devoutly supported by not their own home community, but an international community of believers. Bringing us to lecture 9, how's our time? Can we do 4 more? Let me pick it up. So the Americas, Chaco Canyon, recall it being a difficult one because of the absence of evidence again, but there was, it was the largest place of assembly of a grouping of villages connected by these straight roads in this landscape that went dry, and they had to evacuate, and there's no map, there's supposed to be a map here showing them evacuating to the Rio Grande and abandoning the site. The Chichen Itza site, this remarkable serpent shadow cast on the stairway. And at one point there was a ruler, but he probably was a figurehead because of the evidence of a council operating. And this remarkable landscape centered around these sinkholes that were formed geologically by the boiling of the earth when a huge meteor struck the Yucatan Peninsula, causing the extinction of dinosaurs. Cusco, the Inca city with this remarkable masonry, either straight course or very complex geometry, massive stones, remarkable craftsmanship. Gold didn't have exchange value. It was just useful in ceremonies. And this rich empire building based on these four roads to the four realms of the Inca Empire that intersect at Cusco with these 41 spirit lines commemorating the stone warriors, spirit warriors that led Pachacuti to his victory over rivals establishing the Inca Empire. And these remarkable block, house block system, very carefully controlled. In Cusco, the town of nobility, that would send ambassadors would be sent to occupy the outer areas part of the year, but this is where the nobility lived. And the bonus slide of Machu Picchu, 1450, kind of an elite resort in the mountains with this remarkable water system supported it. Tenochtitlan of the Mexica peoples, in this Diego Rivera representation of the glorious high point with its temple complex and the remarkable island construction, including these gardens, these floating gardens, and the rewriting of the mythological history of the Mexica in order to support the constant renewal of devotion to the gods, which drove an economy of power that kept warfare going and the rulers in control, including human sacrifice. There's that slide of Chaco Canyon relocation. The next lecture is the Mongol legacy. The Mongols were remarkably successful spreading across the region. And they were not builders. They were nomads. They lived in yurts. They even set up a yurt complex when they moved their capital to Beijing. And then it's next to the Chinese tradition after Xian Changlong constructions of the Daming Palace that later became rebuilt under the Ming Dynasty in the Forbidden City, which you did your analysis on, the Hall of Supreme Harmony, this extreme ordering of the hierarchy of Chinese society and civilization. And the Ming Dynasty is the moment when Zheng He travels and overlaps with the Portuguese exploration of the Indian Ocean before being recalled home so that they can invest instead of extensions out in connection with the world, building the next Great Wall of China to keep the rest of the world out. The Mongols also left the Timurid Empire dynasty in control at Samarkand, which was the start of this remarkable Islamic construction of the Registan Square. Uleg Beg, you'll recall, is the man with the observatory and really made tremendous long-lived contributions to the study of astronomy and the sciences. And then in Moscow, we see the Rus were part of the Mongol horde and developed, they went shopping for a religion, and based on the power of Hagia Sophia, there's a connection, they said, the Eastern Church must be the grand one. It was like being in heaven. So they adopt Greek Orthodox Christianity based in Constantinople, and in that tradition, develop an elaborate veneration of iconography, of paintings, and the churches to be the elaborate frames of those paintings. And that led subsequently to Ivan the Terrible and others, czars named after Caesar in the Roman tradition, to conquer Siberia in a bloodletting, genocidal campaign that rivals even what happened in North America. The Mughal Empire expanded under the rule of Shah Jahan, and his orderly rule, his rigorous daily rigor, was manifest and exemplified by the incredible rigor of his constructions, including this mausoleum to his beloved wife, who died young. The absolute precision, the absolute orderliness of this complex was directly in tune with the orderliness of his day, of his rule, of he would meet with this group in the morning and this group in the afternoon. And it was absolutely rigorous, like the architecture. Number 11, Eurasian trading worlds. We start with the Alhambra that was part of Europe until it was redefined. This construction of Charles V, his palace in the Alhambra with the Spanish reconquest of the Iberian Peninsula, in a way, with this architecture of the High Renaissance, redefines Europe to eliminate the sense of a European Islam. And this is something that still continues today, because Islam was very much a part of Europe during centuries of presence in Spain, where it made remarkable contributions, not just to the architectural, social, economic life,
but also to the intellectual life, some would argue, of forming the basis of rational argument and philosophy, building on the Greeks and leading to the Renaissance. A lot of what we think of as Renaissance innovation in philosophy really grew directly out of the contributions of the Moors in Spain.
Did you say this
was? Yes, the job of this architecture, what was it doing? It was working to eliminate the sense of Islam as being a part of Europe. And we still struggle with that. Turkey is doing its best to become a full member of the European community, the European Union, and it's a little bit tough for some Europeans to, you know, hey, wait, they're not European, they're Muslim. So it's a little tricky. And this is part of that same thing. Some would argue it started, or this was a major turning point, where the goal here was to reclaim Spain. It was a reconquest of Spain. It wasn't a conquest of Spain, it was a reconquest of Spain, returning it to its original owners, eliminating the alien forces. Well, those alien forces were present in Europe for about as long as Europeans have been in North America. So you know, we could be susceptible to the same fate, being eliminated from North America and rewriting history as if we never were here. So that's an interesting deployment of architecture. Does that help? Then we move on to Sinan's, the great grand architect of the Ottoman Empire, the Süleymaniye Mosque complex. It's not just the mosque, but the mosque itself is interesting in its garnering of the lessons of Hagia Sophia and redeploying them in an even more carefully and refined way. But here in a complex that includes colleges, a medical college, caravanserai, markets, it's an urban system like we saw in previous Islamic sites. But here on a grander scale, it structures the life of the Muslim community of Constantinople, which is now called Istanbul. And in cooperation and then competition with their trade partners of Venice. The Venetian Republic expands throughout the 15th century, both in partnership and in competition with the Ottoman Empire, that really establishes them at the last moments of its function as the grand emporium of Europe, its connection between Europe and the rest of the world for silk, spices, and trade beyond the Mediterranean. Here we see the Duomo at Florence Cathedral, the remarkable accomplishments of Brunelleschi, the innovative structural techniques of the crane and the ribs and the multiple shells, and the tension ring, using tension instead of pure compression. Pure compression in the Pantheon, the distribution of similar forces in Hagia Sophia and Süleymaniye. Here, finally, we bring tension into the structural system, where it has always been in the Americas, by the way, with their tensile structures, but here we see it used to resist the thrust forces of the dome. And we see, again, this trade from the Spice Islands and Asia, the silks, the spices, coming through through Muslim trade routes, through the Mediterranean, and to the rest of Europe. And here we see the dome in comparison with the Pantheon. A few bonus slides. The Pantheon, there's the dome of Brunelleschi in comparison with the Pantheon, in comparison with Hagia Sophia, the shallowness of the early dome and the later dome that is more resistant. Then we see St. Peter's Basilica from the first half of the course. St. Peter's is a replica of Brunelleschi's Crescent. But it's smaller, less ambitious. The Taj Mahal that we just talked about is a totally different animal, a solid brick dome that has a totally different shape on the outside from the inside, a dome we didn't really talk about. And then St. Paul's Cathedral also making an appearance from the first half of the course, and the U.S. Capitol using cast iron truss system to replicate the historical form of Brunelleschi stone. And then the exception to the Eurasian trading kingdom rule is Japan, which purposefully isolated itself from the rest of the world successfully for 200 years, keeping out the influence of China and the rest of the world, in part by poking holes in the hulls of its ship. They develop an inward-looking, highly refined cultural development. The exception to this were the Dutch, who helped them rout the rebellions of the Christians. And so they were given favored status, but they were connected to Japan by this little architectural element, the bridge. This was the Dutch encampment in Japan in Nagasaki Harbor. Which brings us to the last topic, the Spanish-Portuguese world, shown here with the Treaty of Tordesillas and the Treaty of Zaragoza, splitting the world between these two Iberian Peninsula powers, the Columbian Exchange that Professor Hoy brought up in the slave economies, the Portuguese Church of Goa, where we see a demonstration of the Counter-Reformation Catholic, Roman Catholic Church responding to the challenges of Protestantism to redeploy their resources in favor of theatricality and religious experience of the Baroque materiality, but here in Goa, India, which is part of the Portuguese Jesuit empire that again goes as far as Japan and the Spice Islands. Now we're going to the Spanish in Aztec Mexica, renamed Mexico City, and there's this recognition of the Aztec along with the European, the ringing of the bell that commemorates the revolution in this remarkable, again, Baroque facade, and the establishment of the encomienda system of ranging from slavery to patriarchal organization of labor camps that drives the Spanish economic presence. A similar story of genocide and disease and conquest back in Cusco, where the Spaniards overtake the Inca Empire. And here we see the Coricancha temple in the foreground with the Spanish church built on top of it. No clearer symbolism of what's going on architecturally could be imagined. And the extension of the laws of the Indies system, not so different from what the Romans did with the Roman grid, as a series of towns, several hundred Spanish colonial towns are established where the church, the Plaza Mayor, the grid of the town, and the outward infrastructure of encomienda, oppression outward from that central command post of the Spanish colonial evangelical practice. It wasn't just about money, it was also about souls, because the world was about to end on the final day of judgment. And then finally, Cartagena, where at the fortress of San Felipe, we see the lines of fire in terms of architecture meaning what it means and looking the way it looks because it does what it does. The geometry of projectile motion is the generator of form in conjunction with the geography. The landscape of the harbor, which we see here, is a remarkably fortified position of Cartagena that they close off the Boca Grande opening, leaving only Boca Chica. So when the English come to conquer, they have to bring such an overwhelming force because of the defensive operation, how effective the architectural geographic landscape defense system is. They have to make it through this pinch point, another pinch point here, a third pinch point here, and finally this pinch point here in order to conquer the fortified city. A remarkable deployment of military architecture to maintain this city. Question?
Was that city ever conquered?
Yes, multiple times. It turns out that if you
if you have 130,000 soldiers and 400 ships, you can take even the most heavily fortified city if they only have 2,000 soldiers and a dozen ships. You might lose a lot of people, but if there's enough silver, it's worth it. It's just life. It's just human life. So. Okay? Is that okay?
Do you need to know anything from extra 14 slave economy?
Yes. There's at least two things that we covered very clearly that we were able to take a quiz on. And those questions will also be in the final. Thomas Jefferson's Monticello. It's listed on the sheet. And Elmina Fortress. We almost had enough to do Savannah, Georgia, but wasn't quite. I knocked that off. But Elmina Fortress in Africa and Monticello. Definitely. Other questions? I should say thank you to the TAs. Thank you to Mark Yarsenbeck for giving me this opportunity. This is one of the thrills of my career to teach this course. I hope it shows. I hope you got something out of this course. Thank you very much.